Good morning. Morning, Your Excellencies, industry leaders and representatives of the Group of Vienna, ladies and gentlemen of the press, esteemed partners and colleagues. My name is Jakob Kopperud. I'm the Director of Government and Multilateral Relations, and I'm really delighted to welcome you all to the World Bank Group office here in Paris for this momentous occasion. To sign this important partnership agreement between the International Atomic Energy Agency and the World Bank Group, we're honored to have Mr. Rafael Mariano Grossi, Director General of the IAEA, and Mr. Ajay Banga, World Bank Group President, with us here today. Before they sign the agreement, however, allow me to invite them to say a few words about this partnership that we are embarking on and why it matters to the members of both of our institutions, and more importantly, to the broader community of nations that we serve. Ajay, may I ask you to come and say a few words?
Thank you all for being here, and Jakob, thank you for that introduction. Most importantly, thank you, Rafael, for joining us during, if I may say, a demanding time in your life. Right? I think the fact that he's here, despite all that is going on in his world, just underscores the potential of the journey that we are wanting to embark upon together. Back in 1965, around the same time the World Bank Group last financed a nuclear power project, the average person in high-income countries used about 38 megawatt hours of electricity in a year. Today, that person is using, on the average, more than 50 megawatt hours. But in Africa, that number is 4. So the gap has actually become much worse and far more challenging for the growth and development of our world in a fair way, in a way that this disparity will actually intensify. We were discussing this together a little while ago. Electricity demand in developing countries is projected to more than double by 2035. Meeting that demand will require annual investment in generation, in grids, in storage, to rise from $280 billion today annually to roughly $630 billion. That scale is what drives our effort to connect 300 million people in Africa to electricity by 2030 with the African Development Bank. It's why we developed a very clear path forward on delivering electricity as a driver of development that our board advanced just 2 weeks ago. And one of our board members, the French Executive Director Arnaud, is here. You should know that a lot of the effort we're putting into nuclear also comes with encouragement from the French government over the last year or so of conversation. It's an approach that prioritizes accessibility, affordability, and reliability, delivered in a way that manages emissions in a responsible way. And the goal here is to help countries deliver the energy their people need while giving them the flexibility to choose the path that best fits their ambitions, their development ambitions, their national context, but importantly, also their nationally determined contributions. We believe access to electricity is a fundamental human right. It is the foundation of development. Jobs require electricity, as do health systems, education, clean water, public safety, and so much more. And that level of transformation is not just about generating enough energy to turn on a light and a fan for a few hours in a day. We're talking about enough to power a decent quality of life and support job creation and entrepreneurship. And that means dependable, long-term, baseload power. For the World Bank Group, it means a new way of working and recognizing there is no one-size-fits-all solution. That's why we've got a comprehensive approach. We looked at where can we help to improve grids, where we could help to reduce emissions, and where we could help to expand supply. And along the way, we're trying to clarify our approach and our ability to support geothermal, gas, solar, hydro, wind, all aspects of electricity generation. But what is new is that for the first time in decades, the World Bank Group will begin to re-enter the nuclear energy space. That is new. It's a significant step, and one that we take with care, but importantly with partnership and with purpose. Nuclear is not for every country, but where it is chosen, where it can provide a reliable, clean source of power that strengthens energy security, that supports economic growth, and helps to meet long-term development goals, there we would like to partner. So we are entering nuclear power in three areas. And again, Rafael was actually the one who came and presented to our board at lunchtime in June last year. And we talked about some of these topics. The first one is build capacity and strengthen our ability to advise on non-proliferation safeguards, on safety, on security, and regulatory framework. The second one is extend the life of existing reactors in countries that already have them. You know, rebuilding that fleet and expanding its life is one of the most cost-efficient ways to enable this energy to be used for the right reasons. And of course, the third one is, can we do something together to accelerate the potential of small modular reactors so over a period of time, they can become a more viable option for more countries? The thing is, the World Bank Group cannot do this alone. And that is why the partnership with the IAEA is critical to us. It marks a very tangible first step in our return to nuclear energy. I think it's a privilege for us to have Rafael and his team be a partner with us at every step down the road ahead. We have no intention of not having them locked with us on everything we do here. They bring unmatched expertise in nuclear safety, in security, in safeguards. We think we can help as a World Bank Group support countries where the IAEA is confident in the strength of national laws, in their institutions, in their oversight. That partnership will ensure that we are building capacity and strengthening our ability to advise on non-proliferation safeguards, on safety, on security, and regulatory frameworks. And under this agreement, the idea is that the IAEA will help us build internal capacity across a wide range of topics: energy planning, project lifecycle, fuel management, waste disposal, and the technical infrastructure required for success. That coordinated approach will deepen our understanding of where nuclear energy can play a responsible role and give our clients access to the guidance and the support they need to pursue that path if they choose to take it. We know that challenge is immense, but I think with thanks to this partnership, we think we can help countries deliver the energy they need to power opportunity. Today, we are both talking about more things we can do together with the kind of work that the IAEA is trying to do in healthcare and food as well. And to me, it just tells you, you take the first step, do well together, build the right trust and partnership, and there will be more that the World Bank Group and the IAEA will be delighted to do together. So Rafael, thank you, my friend. Thank you for inspiring us 1 year and 1 month ago. Thank you for staying consistent during that period. And thank you for your partnership and for what lies ahead. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ajay. And Rafael, can I ask you to come and share your thoughts on this partnership as well, please? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Ajay. Well, what a great day this is. And like you were saying, these are not easy times, neither for you, not for us. These days full of anxiety over what is happening in the Middle East, sleepless nights for us, the IAEA. But this is really an inspiration, because this shows us that when we work together, when we have a good idea, when we have a determination to do something and to change things, this is possible. And I really want to pay homage to you for having believed, Ajay, that this was possible. For many, many years, a narrative was saying that this was not possible. And for many, many years, and those here, my friends from the private sector, the nuclear industry, the guys really doing the stuff, were hitting a wall that was saying that investing in nuclear was not something for international finance institutions. And among those, the leading one, because nothing, ladies and gentlemen, nothing will happen without the World Bank. Is as simple as that. In my endless rounds of conversations in many parts of the world, when I was approaching banks and regional banks and financing people, they were saying, "But did you know the World Bank, this and that?" And this is when I decided to come to Ajay and just tell him and ask him. And he graciously invited me, as you were saying, to talk to the board at lunch. And I can tell you the first reaction, even from nuclear users, was not too, welcoming. They were saying, it's going to be complicated. It's many years. And you said, hell no. And I'm so grateful for that, because I was convinced that we had a good story to tell. And this is what we did. And I think, of course, in terms of how international institutions work, and God knows how much reform these international institutions need. But I think 1 year is not bad. In one year, from the very first time I talked to you and to your board and I explained what nuclear was doing and what it could do, our teams started working together, meeting in Vienna, in Washington, you sending me your experts. I'm sending you my people to explain the things that could be seen as self-evident for us, but until you get to talk to the other side of the street, and this applies to everything, my dear friends, this applies to war and peace issues as well. Until you get to that point, nothing will happen. And we did it. So I want to first, like I said, pay homage and say thanks. And I also want to say thanks to the industry. When I first became Director General of the IAEA, the first thing I did is to ask my people, where is the dialogue with the nuclear industry? And it was nowhere to be found. And this is why I created the Group of Vienna. We meet, we discuss things, we are together. They know that at the end of the day, we are there to service them and to serve countries. So you said everything that needed to be said in terms of energy. I will not repeat that in terms of what the countries need, in terms of where the necessities are. But one big problem we had, and this was the lack of finance. The fact that many, many clients in the global south, in developing countries, even in industrialized economies, need some financing support. And now they know they can come, they will know. They can come to the World Bank, they can talk to the World Bank, they can explain what they want to do in different areas, starting with, as we were mentioning now, life extensions, but also doing feasibility studies, looking into the safety of the whole thing. And the World Bank will be able to tell them, we have our friends in Vienna, the IAEA, we can look at concrete projects, see the feasibility of them and work together. So without falling into the solemnities and saying that this is a historic occasion or whatever, I think this is a very important day. And I think you will agree with me, at least on that one. Let me tell you that already when Ajay comms people were putting out a message that we were going to be meeting, I had the same day calls from some, I'm a diplomat, I will not mention which regional banks, but they were calling me, how did you do it? Well, I was talking to you about this for many, many years. Now, welcome to the club, if you want, because this is a good club. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rafael. Now, without further ado, over to the signing of the agreement. I can confirm the pens are very steady.
Very nice, very nice. It's well marked pens, you know.
Yes, sir. No. No. Thank you. Right.